Three prisoners were sentenced to death. One of them French, one of them German, one of them Belgian. "What is your last wish?" they ask the French guy. He says, "A bottle of exquisite French wine." "What is your last wish?" they ask the German guy. He says, "I want to give a speech." "What is your last wish?" they ask the Belgian guy. He says, "I want to get shot before the German starts his speech." Unfortunately for you guys, it is too late now. My speech will be about the simplest way of explaining the universe. The universe is following strange rules: Einstein's general relativity, Planck's quantum physics. But it may be even stranger than you think, and the universe may be even simpler than you think. Many scientists are now taking seriously the possibility that all of reality is being computed by a short computer program, as first suggested in 1967 by Konrad Zuse, the same Konrad Zuse who, from 1935 until 1941, built the first working general-purpose program-controlled computer. The idea is that every electron behaves the same way because all electrons are essentially using and reusing the same piece of code, the same subprogram, again and again. To make this plausible, consider a video game with a realistic three-dimensional simulation. The program that defines the rule of this game is a series of zeros and ones in your computer. If you look at this program, you don't see what it does. You have to run it to experience it. Now, it is true that reality still has much better resolution than video games. But soon, you will see no difference no more, because simulations are getting better by a factor of 1,000 per decade and Swiss franc. But in any case, in a few decades, we will have a factor of a billion. This means that soon we will be able to simulate very convincing heavens and hells. And soon it will seem very plausible indeed that all of reality maybe also is just a simulation. To a man with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. To a man with a computer, everything looks like a computation. Skeptics might say, "What about quantum physics and Heisenberg's uncertainty principle? And Bell's inequality, don't these things show that the universe cannot be computed by a simple deterministic computer program?" And the short answer is, not at all. For example, Bell himself, he knew well that a deterministically computed universe with deterministically computed observers like ourselves is totally compatible with all existing physical observations. There is no physical evidence against this possibility. You know, before I came here, I thought this is going to be just another TEDx talk and there won't be much of an audience, but you are actually a large audience by my standards. The other day, I gave a talk and there was just a single person in the audience. A young lady, I said, "Young lady, it's very embarrassing, but apparently today I'm going to give this talk just to you." And she said, "Okay, but please hurry, I gotta clean up here." In the 1980s, when my brother was a teenager in Munich, he told me and everybody else whom he met that the universe, or the quantum multiverse is the sum of all mathematics. He was younger than me. My brother is still younger than I am. And he also was smarter than me, and he went on to become a theoretical physicist, first in Munich, then at Caltech, at Princeton, at CERN, and he lived in Bern, next door to where Einstein lived, not at the same time. The sum of all mathematics. For a while, I didn't fully understand what that means, but then, in 1996, I was able to formulate this idea through a computation, pointing out that one can generalize Everett's multiverse theory, pointing out that there's a very short program, a short and fast program, that not only computes this universe, if it is computable, but there's no evidence against this possibility, not only this universe, but also all other logically possible universes, including those with different physical laws, for example, universes where there's anti-gravity. In fact, there is a fastest, most efficient, mathematically optimal way of computing all possible universes, all logically possible computable universes. An optimal way that is better than any other. I wrote it down for you. It has only 10 lines of code. Fits on this little piece of paper, 10 lines of code, the optimal way of simulating or computing every logically possible universe. It works like this. You essentially systematically enumerate all possible programs through a program, and then you allocate runtime to all of these programs in an optimal way that makes sure that each possible universe history is being computed as quickly as if it were computed by this universe's fastest program, which we usually do not know in advance. Fastest, say, for a constant factor, which does not depend on the size of the universe history so far. The universe itself might be maybe infinite. Now, any self-respecting, godlike, great programmer should use this optimal method to create and become the master of all logically possible universes. He should not use a suboptimal method. That's the one that he should use. Suppose he does that. Then, after some time, many of the universes that are being computed by this optimal way will contain a copy of you. And of you, as you are looking at me with incredulous eyes. Now, you yourself could even become a great programmer by just taking this piece of code, programming it on your own computer, and simulating all possible universes. Given the properties of the optimal method, it is now easy to see that at a given point in time, most of the copies of yourself, of the universes that contain a copy of your life, will be due to one of the fastest and shortest programs that is compatible with your existence. This simple insight allows us to make predictions about the future. There are many possible futures of your life so far. Which one is going to happen? Answer, most likely one of the few regular, non-random futures that can be computed by a fast and short program. Because randomness, random stuff, where everything suddenly dissolves into arbitrariness, is fundamentally harder to compute than regular stuff, even by the optimal method. This means that beta decay, the decay of neutrons, which is widely believed to be random, cannot really be random. It has to be pseudo-random. Just like the decimal expansion of pi, which looks random, but isn't. because it can be computed by a short program. A consequence of the optimal method of computing everything is also that quantum computation is not going to work well. I first made this, and the reason is because it's consuming so much traditional computation power. I made this prediction 12 years ago, and since then there has not been any progress in practical quantum computing. So quantum computers are sexy, but essentially they are dead. What about free will? Free will is overrated. In my lab, at the Swiss Artificial Intelligence Lab, IDSIA, we often program simulated worlds inhabited by simulated agents, driven by simulated artificial brains containing simulated artificial neural networks. In the beginning, these guys are very dumb, and over time, they become smarter. Through pseudo-random trial and error, they figure out how to solve problems that they were not able to solve in advance, in the beginning. They have no idea that every single thought of their little artificial brains and the little artificial neural networks in their brains is totally deterministically computed by a program that does not have any random aspects. Nevertheless, computer science and the whole line of reasoning that I now try to outline within 15 minutes is now offering formal mathematical answers to old questions of philosophy and theology. For example, one of the consequences of this computational theology is that your own life must be very important in the grand scheme of things. You may think that your life is insignificant because you are so small and the universe is so big. However, given the optimal way of computing everything, and given the probability distribution induced by this optimal way, probably it's very hard to edit your life out of this history, of the current history of this universe. Because the program that computes this universe, or one that is very much like it, but without you and without your life, with all its ups and downs, is probably much longer and therefore much slower than the original program, which does contain your life, which is totally interconnected with everything else that is happening in this computable world, if it is computable indeed. So your life, from this perspective, is not insignificant. It is an indispensable part of the grand scheme of things. This is compatible with religions that claim all is one and everything is connected to everything. May this thought lift you up in times of frustration. I wish to thank the organizers for doing a great job and for the check which I'm going to spend on the education of my kids. I wish to thank my mom and my dad and the great programmer without whom all of this would not have been possible. I wish to thank my kids, without whom all of this would not have been necessary. And I wish to thank you, my lovely audience, for your patience.